we pose the question to Deke Roussel.
If we argue backwards, teleologically, through the wrong end of the telescope, right, from Steven Spielberg and Jaws, straight back to La Rosseur au Rosset, the kid stepping on the thing, or you know, go argue back through Keaton, Chaplin, you know, to this little piece of comedy, you know, that's where you end up. The more interesting question, you know, would be to take another early popular Lumiere film, one that was, I say popular, it was shown in a lot of early programs, shown in a lot of first programs, and is kind of a mystery to everybody, which nobody can understand. And that is a film called Boat Leaving Harbor. And you see in this film called Boat Leaving Harbor, a kind of a rowboat with waves, and the guys are starting to row, and in the background you see a little jetty with a couple of people walking on it. Then it's leaving a harbor down by Montpellier or down by the summer, in La Ciotat, I think it is, you know, is where it's shot, if I remember correctly, down by the summer home of the Lumieres. And here are these guys rowing in this boat. The boat goes out into somewhere in the middle of the image, and it hits its, you know, 62 seconds, and it ends. Now, this was a revelation, this film. This was really an exciting film to people. It was shown in lots of the first programs all over the world. It's one of the best, it's preserved in lots of archives. I've got copies of this thing. Why in the world is anybody interested in this film? It has kind of no beginning and no end in the narrative sense. It doesn't tell a story. What was the fascination? Why were audiences at the time interested in this film? The answer is because they had been seeing movement on a screen, projected movement on a screen, since at least the 1660s. So for 400 years, 300 years, there had been movement on the screen. But that movement was always limited. It was a moving slide or a slipping slide or a mechanical slide that the windmill turned, the sails turned, or the nose went in and out, or something else happened. And what you see in this little Lumiere film of the boat leaving the harbor is movement all across the screen. You see waves kind of constantly coming in, every edge. You see no mechanical movement at all. You see natural movement. This is why the critic who wrote for one of the either New York City or Rochester, New York papers, it's because it's in George Pratt's book, about Feeding the Baby, another one of the early Lumiere films, particularly said, and you can see the leaves in the background fluttering, because you're getting movement here across the entire screen. What's that in contrast to? That's in contrast to every single living person's experience of the magic lantern and the mechanistic limited movement from magic lantern slides, even from dissolves. This is the visual context and what it was that was new that cinema brought into the world, and everybody got very excited about this at the time because they had experienced so much movement, so many moving images, so much, but this was of a different quality, of a different order, of a different size, and opened up for the first time, just blasted open new possibilities. And of course, those new possibilities, you know, by the 1920s, had created a whole industry, which everybody who still lived in the 1920s then wanted to say, I invented.
But at the end of the day, where should we place the Lumières in regard to the birth of cinema?
So, prominent, because they've been pushed by four generations worth of French nationalist historians, and by the government, they almost made it onto a 100-franc note at one point at the time of the centenary, all this kind of stuff. And because the French love the cinema and are very important in this. They were important in the teens, they're important in the 20s, they're important again in the 50s, they're important again in the 60s. You know, I mean, this is a great film culture, you know, at which the Lumières stand at the head. But if we want to talk about the invention of moving pictures, you got to talk about a lot of other people, too. Not to denigrate the Lumières at all, but to say that they were part of an elaborate pattern of things that was going on, in which they played a major role, but not maybe even the decisive role.